Hello and welcome to this video lecture for the University of Connecticut's online course, Classics and Ancient Mediterranean Studies 1103, Classical Mythology. I'm Roger Travis, Associate Professor of Classics at the University of Connecticut, and whether you're enrolled in this course or not, I hope you enjoy the lecture and learn something about new ways of looking at classics and at myth. Thanks for watching.
This lecture is about Calypso and about what she can tell us both about Odysseus himself and about the way the Odyssey works as a myth. And the best way I've found to introduce all of that is to use a song about Calypso by Suzanne Vega from 1987. And the song is called Calypso.
And I have lived alone. I live on an island. Struggle with the sea. I knew that he was drowning, and I brought him into me. Now today, come morning light, he sails away after one last night. I let him go. My name is Calypso, my garden overflows. Thick and wild and hidden is the sweetness there that grows. My hair it blows long as I sing into the wind. I tell of nights where I could taste the salt on his skin. Salt of the wind.
This is at line 116 of Book 5. So he spoke, and Calypso, shining among divinities, shuddered, and answered him in winged words, and addressed him, "You are hard-hearted, you gods, and jealous beyond all creatures beside, when you are resentful toward the goddesses for sleeping openly with such men as each has made her true husband. So when Dawn of the Rosy Fingers chose out Orion, all you gods who live at your ease were full of resentment, until chaste Artemis of the Golden Throne in Ortygia came with a visitation of painless arrows and killed him. And so it was when Demeter of the lovely hair, yielding to her desire, lay down with Iasion and loved him in a thrice-turned field. It was not long before this was made known to Zeus, who struck him down with a cast of the shining thunderbolt."
Gone forevermore, and the waves will take him in again, but he'll know their ways now. I will stand upon the shore with a clean heart and my song in the wind. The sand may sting my feet, and the sky will burn. It's a lonely time ahead. I do not ask him.
Now, there are two things I want to tease out of that song as a way of moving us forward to thinking about Calypso and her relationship to the rest of the Odyssey. The first way is what I'm going to call the double standard. And by double standard, I pretty much mean what we mostly mean when we use the term in everyday conversation. That is, the way that different sets of standards are applied to men and to women. Now, one of the ways to talk about the Odyssey is to talk about the fact that Odysseus gets to sleep with Calypso and Circe and presumably others while he's in Troy and then out on the sea, but Penelope has to remain completely faithful. And the standard way to respond to that is to say that, well, there's a double standard in ancient Greece that's even stronger than the double standard we have today. We can't judge Odysseus on that basis because that would be anachronistic. And that would be fine, except for this moment in Book 5, which proves that it's not exactly true for the whole of the Odyssey, because as we just saw, in the same way that Suzanne Vega gets us to identify with Calypso and see her as a kind of injured party in the leaving of Odysseus, the Odyssey itself has Calypso refer to the double standard. It has her criticize the gods because the gods refuse to let goddesses like Calypso, like Demeter, have their human consorts. So at the very least, Calypso as a figure in the Odyssey lets us think about whether the bards who are telling this story are trying to get their audiences to think about the double standard that existed in archaic Greece. Just as these days when we see a movie or listen to a song that has us sympathize with a woman who is the victim of the double standard, we're obviously supposed to think about that. We're supposed to question the truth value of the double standard, which itself creates a new kind of truth value Rudy thing of, well, we're part of a culture that questions its double standards, even though it still has them. The other theme that I want to tease out of Suzanne Vega's song Calypso comes in the lyrics, "My name is Calypso, my garden overflows, thick and wild and hidden is the sweetness there that grows." And Suzanne Vega takes this directly from a moment that begins at line 63, of Book 5 of the Odyssey. "There was a growth of grove around the cavern, flourishing. Alder was there, and the black poplar and fragrant cypress, and there were birds with spreading wings who made their nests in it, little owls and hawks and birds of the sea with long beaks who are like ravens, but all their work is on the seawater. And right about the hollow cavern extended a flourishing growth of vine that ripened with grape clusters. Next to it there were four fountains, and each of them ran shining water, each next to each, but turned to run in sundry directions. And round about there were meadows growing soft with parsley and violets, and even a god who came into that place would have admired what he saw, the heart delighted within him." So Calypso's garden is a flourishing place, we might say. The reason to talk about this really doesn't occur until we get further on in the Odyssey, after Odysseus arrives in the land of the Phaeacians, which is an island called Scyria. And now we're in Book 7 of the Odyssey at line 112, and this is what Odysseus sees when he first comes to the house of Alcinous, the king of the Phaeacians. "On the outside of the courtyard and next the doors is his orchard, a great one, four land measures with a fence driven all around it. And there is the place where his fruit trees and pomegranate trees and apple trees with their shining fruit and the sweet fig trees and the flourishing olive. Never is the fruit spoiled on these, never does it give out, neither in winter time nor summer, but always the west wind blowing on the fruit brings some to ripeness while he starts others. Pear matures on pear in that place, apple upon apple, grape cluster on grape cluster, fig upon fig. There also he has a vineyard planted that gives abundant produce, some of it a warm area on level ground where the grapes are left to dry in the sun, but elsewhere they are gathering others and trampling out yet others, and in front of these are unripe grapes that have cast off their bloom while others are darkening. And there at the bottom strip of the field are growing orderly rows of greens, all kinds, and these are lush through the seasons. And there two springs distribute water, one through all the garden space, and one on the other side jets out by the courtyard door, and the lofty house where townspeople come for their water. Such are the glorious gifts of the gods at the house of Alcinous." It's the contrast between Calypso's garden and Alcinous's orchard that's the most important thing here, and that's what I'm going to be talking about in the next segment.